Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Today, we're back in War Thunder, and it's time to talk about another aircraft which I've an argument for. I believe it should be in-game, but maybe not in the main tree, but definitely in a gift tree or gift aircraft setting. There are a few vehicles that I've talked about in the past which would be perfect for the gift vehicle setting, which we find in the War Thunder Chronicles or the Christmas events, which I would like to see in the game, and this is another one. It is probably one of the most popular planes which never really made its massive mark in history. But if you are a person who is interested in the RAF and some of the weird and wonderful ideas that the British had in World War II, including some of their tank designs and some of their aircraft designs, you will have definitely heard of this. I'm of course talking about the Bolton Paul Defiant. It is a twin-seater, single-engine interceptor slash night fighter slash turret fighter, which is maybe something you've never heard before if you've never heard of this aircraft. It was used in a defensive-minded night fighter way, primarily over Britain during World War II. This was going to be the wonderful answer to take on the Luftwaffe bombers in a night fighter role. Well, let's just say it didn't exactly happen in that way, but we'll go through its history and then I'll talk about why I would like to see it in a gift setting. So, in the interwar years, we saw a vast shift to more modern and potential aircraft platforms. So what we would class in this is Hurricanes, Spitfires, stuff like that, compared to the old Gloster Gladiators and Nimrods and so forth. The Bolton Paul Defiant, it followed as only the RAF's third such monoplane. So this was the third monoplane idea which was brought ahead. And also, the Defiant also became the RAF's first four-machine gun fighter. So this has its place in history as the third of such a type of monoplane to come about, and also the first one which had four machine guns, which obviously isn't a big accolade when you have stuff running around with 12 7.7s, but still, it's a decent amount of guns. The Defiant rose to prominence because of the Air Ministry. The Air Ministry specification F9/35, it called for a twin-seat monoplane fighter with all of its armaments concentrated in a rear-mounted, hydraulically-powered dorsal turret. So when I talked about the Whitley bomber the other day, one of the big upgrades that the Mark IV, I believe, and also the Mark V had was this hydraulically-powered dorsal turret. But what they wanted to do was take that and put it on some other aircraft because it was such a good technological advancement before even the war started, when it was being developed. And then, for whatever reason, war planners were high on the idea of an fighter aircraft sporting a battery of concentrated firepower in a powered turret system. So the idea of getting in front of the enemy and then shooting backwards with the powered turret. Obviously, when it came about, it didn't really work too well. But still, this idea was thrown around a lot by the Air Ministry, so they thought, why not give it a go? The idea was that the aircraft could maneuver its way in front or into an enemy bomber formation and wreak havoc with its excellent armament, and all while able to protect itself from pesky enemy fighters. So, yeah, that was kind of the downfall, the fact that it couldn't really defend itself with no forward armament, and also, well, we'll get into some of the issues, which may not really be the Defiant's fault in the end, but it still had the issues historically. So, Bolton Paul already had some experience in producing such weird concepts by building some of 59 Hawker Demon aircraft in the early to mid-1930s, so they knew what they were doing. These aircraft were fighter developments of the Hawker Hart and sported an enclosed gun turret at the rearward portion of the fuselage, so this could be another gift aircraft. But I feel like focusing on the Defiant is probably more well-known, so therefore that should come first. The turrets were designed by Fraser Nash and proved to be a sound solution to the issues that the Air Ministry had. It allowed for heavy armament and also better gun sights to be fitted and work in conjunction with the gunner's tendencies. And then early forms of the turret were manually powered, and drafty but external power sources and enclosures of frame and glass were soon developed to evolve the design to its more traditional form. So what we're talking about there is changing an open canopy to a closed canopy. Maybe if you compare the SM-39's back gunner on the top, where he has quite an open canopy, compare that to on the Lancaster on the booty, where it has that turret on the back. Very much different ways of doing it, and also making sure that your turret gunner does not die of hypothermia. The Defiant was an interesting concept to say, well, maybe not hypothermia, maybe just frost or just coldness. Let's just say coldness. Pneumonia might be a better, better one to talk about. Anyway, back to the Defiant. The Defiant, it was an interesting concept, at least compared to what was being made at the time, such as the BF-109 or the ME-109. The BF-110, the Spitfire, the Hurricane, it was definitely a lot different. In many ways, it actually went back to the World War I days, where scout airplanes were being armed for self-defense while being sent out to the front to spy on enemy ground targets. These early aircraft sported simple defensive armaments in a rear-placed cockpit. You may have actually seen these in battlefields. Is it Battlefield 1, I believe, the World War 1 game, where there is a bomber in that game which has a rear-mounted turret, pretty much that concept, but on a single-engined fighter. This provided the rear gunner with an adequate field of fire from trailing enemy fighters. And in practice, this concept worked, but it's still interesting to compare that line of early century thinking with the developments of the interwar years nonetheless. Obviously, it is nice to see that we made progress through that time, but there were still some people who believed in the old ideas which still came about. So there were two Defiant prototypes, which went, or at least the first one, went airborne on the August 11th, 1937, with an order of 400 following. So they were definitely impressed with the idea, and it obviously met with the specification, so what they wanted to do was bring it into actual service. However, only three were actually in RAF hands by the outset of World War II. So we have a bit of France and Italian syndrome here, where they order a ton of vehicles, and then none of them really show up. And that's mainly down to the fact that maybe it was hard to make, or maybe just because they wanted to focus on other aircraft. Within time, deliveries were actually built up, and the number 264 squadron got the deliveries, and they made them first operational in a Defiant group on the 8th of December 1939, so about 2.5 years after the initial prototype, which isn't a terrible amount of time, that's a decent amount of time. The aircraft and her air crews would have to wait until May, or the 12th of May 1940, to actually get their first taste of combat against the German Luftwaffe, so we were nearly talking about a whole year from prototype to action, which isn't actually that bad. It's more like, well, it's more like 10 months or so. Early results proved promising, as the aircraft served up no fewer than 65 enemy air kills before the end of May 1940, thanks to its excellent armament load. So it actually killed a decent amount of aircraft in about 20 days, which is impressive for, you know, when you look back at it in history, you don't think that this thing would have killed anything, but at least it did something. The bread and butter of the Defiant system lay in, of course, its hydraulically powered rear turret. Unsuspecting enemy pilots, thinking the Defiant was as susceptible from attacks from the rear, were greeted with a hail of the 4.77mm or the 303 caliber Browning air-cooled machine guns. The machine guns were paired two aside, so very similar to the turret you see on the back of the Wellington Mark 10, and the entire turret system could scan a 360-degree area above the aircraft. Visibility was pretty much hampered by the heavy framing around the glassy enclosure, but in theory, the layout was deemed acceptable. 600 rounds of 7.7 ammunition were afforded each gun, so that is, what, 2,400 rounds for this turret in total. and bringing the guns to bear successfully on an enemy aircraft usually yielded favorable results to Defiant crews. And that was obviously if an enemy fighter pilot would be foolish to contend with an aircraft from the rear. So basically they were hoping for enemy fighters to sit on their rear, maybe believing it was a different aircraft, maybe a Hurricane or something, and then open up the guns, open up the batteries, and absolutely annihilate them. Surprisingly, did pretty well. Despite the early successes, though, the Luftwaffe crews eventually realized the limits of the Defiant in its entirety. The turret, even though it had a lot of firepower on it, proved to add substantial drag and weight to the Defiant airframe, which resulted in a very poor performance when compared to the later Luftwaffe aerial implements. Performance was everything to a dogfighting aircrew, and the Defiant just would not suffice in the role because it just wasn't fast enough compared to the German forces, at least not in the long term. So an extended battle, it would not be able to do much. Once it became common knowledge, based on the experience that the Defiant mounted no forward-facing defensive armament whatsoever, the Luftwaffe crews made it their strategy to attack the aircraft from the front, which obviously makes a lot of sense. So even though the four-gun armament of the Defiance could be brought to bear in the forward position, this was not really happened that much because they wanted to protect the aircraft's rear, which was the main priority of the Defiant crews. As expected, the losses of the aircraft type began to mount to the point that the Defiant was pulled from daytime action in August of 1940. So it lasted a summer, and with some initial success, just like a lot of aircraft have, what happened was, well, the enemy figured it out. This is very similar to a lot of aircraft that we see in World War II, where it takes a bit of time for the enemy to work out what it is, how it fights, what guns it has on it, and once they figure that out, it's a hell of a lot easier to fight. So even though it was pulled from daytime action in August 1940, that was not the end of the story for the wonderful Defiant. They were reinstituted back into action as converted night fighters, and Defiants were now fielded with a new mark, the Defiant NF Mark 1, and were naturally based on the standard Mark 1 marks from earlier. And then we had the NF Mark 1A, so we even have more variants of the Defiant, which followed soon afterwards with the potent AI Mark 4/6 interception radar systems for increased lethality in the dark of night. So the only real difference is a radar system. So if you are going to put two variants of the Defiant in game, one would have to be the premium tree or the gift tree, and one would have to be in the standard tree, because obviously if you put both of these variants in the same standard tree, it would just kind of annoy players having to do the same aircraft twice, maybe one being slightly heavier, but that's really about it. The British were already proving themselves masters with the radar development, which is something I want to get into in another video, maybe a historic one, because it did make a large difference in World War II that a lot of people don't really think about. But they would utilize this expertise throughout its defensive perimeter during the Battle of Britain. So during the span of 1940 to 1941, the Defiant accounted for more enemy air kills than any other RAF aircraft could boast. Just think about that. The good old Defiant was higher than stuff that you would think would be controlling the skies. It's a very impressive statistic considering the RAF also had the Hurricane and the Spitfires. At its peak of use, no fewer than 13 RAF squadrons were fielding Defiants in the defensive role. I mean, they weren't fighting fighters and bombers at the same time. They were using, you know, the night fighter tactics, so that would help quite a lot. They could sneak up on the enemies, sit around them, and then the turret could unleash. But still, just think about it. You hear all the time about how good the Spitfires were. You don't really hear that about the Hurricanes. I wish we did. I wish they were more remembered, especially for the Battle of Britain. But the Defiant beat both of them in this span of time with enemy air kills. Just insane to think about. The Defiant Mark 1, though, obviously had a few issues. The top speed was 304 miles per hour with a 404 mile range, obviously not great. The service ceiling was reported at approximately 30,000 feet, which made it comparable to other early forms of monoplane fighters. And the power was derived from a single Rolls-Royce brand Merlin 3 series liquid-cooled V12 piston engine of 1,030 horsepower. A total of 723 Mark 1 series were actually produced. And then the Defiant NF Mark 2s, which followed the Mark 1 series into the fold. The differences were that these were improved versions of the previous base Mark, but were more dedicated platforms to fulfill the night fighter role, with differences including an increase in its vertical tail surface and implementation of the radar we talked before. The Defiant NF Mark II series sported specifications that were a bit different. The top speed was 313 miles per hour, so once again very similar, and around about 30,000 feet service ceiling once again. The range was also increased though to 465, so it could carry a bit more fuel, and also the power was now derived from a single Rolls-Royce Merlin XX series piston, which I believe is 20. I might be wrong on that though. Series piston engine of 1,280 horsepower, 210 total NF Mark II models were produced. So even though we have a different engine in this case, a different radar system, I still believe this should be at the same BR as the other one, since the only real difference between them is 9 miles per hour max speed, which doesn't really make that much of a difference. With an increased vertical tail surface, maybe that means that it's a bit more maneuverable, so it really depends on the acceleration of the Rolls-Royce Merlin 20, and also the maneuverability that the tail surface gives it. So that is something that we'll have to work out in-game if it's that much of a difference. Additional marks became the ASR Mark 1 model series. These were issued as air sea rescue platforms fitted with dinghies on the underside, which would be interesting to have in game. A new gameplay mechanic, maybe an aerialistic. I have talked about in the past, being able to bring back stuff like Catalinas and OS2Us, where maybe a plane crashes in the water, or maybe some people are in the water, you have to land on the water and you have to be able to pick them up and take them back to base. You get maybe a few more tickets. Well, the Bolton Pole could just drop its dinghies and off you go, you're all good. The TT Mark 1s were nothing more than target tug conversion models, so, pretty much target practice ones, they basically would drag stuff behind them for the RAF to use as target practice. This was generally used for aircraft which were not seeing mainline service, and therefore, they were just left to be target tug aircraft. About 150 of these were converted, the Mark 1s, and then the Mark 3 TT, or the TT Mark 3, were also target tug aircraft, and there was 140 of them when the new build system with the four-gun turret. So despite its early successes, and obviously the increasing losses that followed that, the Defiant found a niche in the night fighter role, which suited it quite well. The advancements in nighttime radar definitely helped it, and extended the life of the Defiant, as did Britain's need for more defensive measures. But the lack of front-facing armament no doubt was an oversight in the design, and also Bolton Paul engineers did what they could with the specification that they were given. So there is no fault on the Bolton Paul's part, it is fault on the Air Ministries for not wanting to have offensive armaments. In the end though, the Bolton Paul Defiant was a memorable part of military aviation history just because it was so odd and actually surprisingly worked, at least, a little bit. And even though it may have had a rocky and forgettable tale, it is definitely one of those things that still is on everyone's mind if they know stuff about the RAF history, especially in World War II. So the main... That's pretty much its history of it, so we'll go into the gameplay side of it just a little bit here. The main issues that the Defiant has in-game is, first of all, it will be very easy to tell that it's a Defiant instead of something like a Hurricane. So therefore, the enemy team will know how to approach you. They'll approach you from the front, so therefore it'll come down to its maneuverability. The maneuverability of the Defiant is okay, but it's nothing special compared to the Spitfire or the Hurricane, so it's going to have to be a low BR. At the same time, its maximum speed is absolutely awful compared to a lot of the aircraft. So what we're talking about here is a rank 1 aircraft, and because of its oddities that it only has the rear turret with 4.77s and no offensive armaments and no bombs or anything like that, I believe it should be a gift vehicle. My modus operandi when it comes to gift vehicles is that there should be interesting, weird and wacky vehicles instead of just better versions of what we have in the standard tree. So the Ersatz M10, which we just got, which is at 5.7 still, is just a flat out better version of the Panther D that we have at 5.7. I don't like that. I don't like the idea of the most experienced players in the game getting better vehicles than people who are new to the game. I don't think that should be something. That's why I don't like the I-301, that's why I don't like the I-29. What I prefer is stuff which is a little bit worse than its counterparts in the tree, but maybe a little bit more interesting. And the Defiant would definitely fall into that category. Maybe around 1.7 to try and deal with some of the heavy bomber spam that we see at lower tiers, which still hasn't been addressed for a long time. So it would be nice to see it there. It would obviously need some kind of spawn, maybe an attacker spawn or a interceptor spawn, something like that. But all of those can be ironed out with time. It's definitely a machine which should be in the game, though. And hopefully it does. Hopefully maybe we get two versions. You could get a normal tree version, and then you get a gift version. The fact that there was about 5 different variants made, I mean, 3 of them are pretty much the same. The only 2 different ones being the Mark 1, or the NF Mark 1 and the NF Mark 2. You know, that means that we could get a standard tree and a gift vehicle version. Maybe the standard tree one comes after the gift vehicle, so therefore the people who get the gift can feel like they have got something at least before it's going to come out in the standard tree. That, to me, would be cool. So hopefully, this comes to the game in the next year or so. It would be nice to see, even though it will probably be used for like half a week and then never seen again. It's still something that should be represented in a game like War Thunder. I hope you all have a wonderful day, and I'll see you next time.